Hello, in this video I'm going to be making a new one of these. This is my icosahedron and this one was actually made in 1996. Back in those days I used an original scoop and I sculptured pieces like this and made moulds of them and then cast resin pieces and added them on like that. These pieces actually, I removed the caps before I put them on, but you can kind of see how it fits together. Now, after the prototype in 1996, I then went on and made some better ones, including this one that I sold. And this one's really nice quality. Now, by the time you watch this video, I'll probably have sold this one, but I wanted to kind of include it into this video. So, how am I going to make the new ones? Well, it's going to be pretty similar, but I'm going to kind of update a few things. Firstly, I'm going to use one of these scoops, which is much better because it's kind of like suitable for speed cubing, which means that there's corner cutting, which means that it's not going to pop very easily. These Meffet scoops could pop. I mean, they weren't terrible, but there were some popping issues, let's say. Now, I don't want to sculpture these by hand now because that takes a lot of work and it's very difficult to get them accurate. So I'm going to be doing some CAD work using Google SketchUp, which I don't really enjoy doing, but sometimes I just kind of have to get the puzzle made. So here you can see the CAD work I was working on. Obviously I'm well into the project here. So basically I've put a cube inside an icosahedron, and then I'm creating the correct lines. So then I can kind of cut out the parts I don't need, and I'll have three pieces that I can then get 3D printed. So here are the three pieces separated. You can see how I've made them hollow. That's because when they're 3D printed, it costs quite a lot of money. And so you make them like the least amount of volume to them as possible. The bottom two triangles look the same, but they're actually mirror images of each other. So I do need these three pieces to create the masters for the puzzle. So the next stage is to convert the files into DAE files. I can also do that with Google SketchUp. And then I'll upload these files to Shapeways, and then I can pay to have them 3D printed, and then they'll post them to me. Right, so here are the 3D printed parts. I'm very happy with the quality and they seem to have come out really well. Now, as I stated, I wanted to use as least material as possible because that's cheaper when you're ordering from Shapeways. But that means the cavities are too sort of big to include in the moulds. So what I've done already is I've put milliput into these cavities. So the moulding process is a lot easier. You can do kind of two-part moulds where you're putting resin in one part and then in the other part, and then bringing the moulds together when they've kind of partly gone off. But that doesn't always work very well. So although I'm going to be using two-part moulds, I want to kind of do it in a single process. That will become clear a little bit later.
So here's the rubber I'm going to be using to make the moulds. I'm going to be mixing it with a fast catalyst. Usually it would take about a day to go off, but with the catalyst it's taken about 2 hours. I'm making two part moulds for each piece. So that's the first half done, and the rubber is set, and just a case of setting it up to the second halves. I'm using plasticine here to create like little keys, so the second halves will line up properly with the first halves. Just, you can do this with anything really, just like little to create little dents. This will stop the rubber from sticking to itself too much. I've actually ruined moulds in the past by not putting enough of it on, and you just can't pull them apart. So that's the second lot of rubber set, and now it's just a case of taking them out of the little plastic containers and separating the pieces. At this stage, it's looking good. Occasionally, you can like end up with some great big air bubble or something, and the whole sort of thing's destroyed. But I'm very happy with these. The first of the triangular pieces. And the second triangular piece. Yep, all three are looking good to me. Right, so now I'm using polyester casting resin with a catalyst and a black dye to make the actual pieces I'll be using on the puzzle. I used polyester resin originally, like years and years ago, but I stopped using it because it's quite sort of dirty and smelly, and it's not very easy to use. So I moved on to the much cleaner polyurethane resin, but that had some issues with outgassing, which means stickers will bubble like for years and years later, sort of thing. So now I've gone back to polyester resin for some puzzles. I'm using this wire to sort of push into all the nooks and crannies, because otherwise you get air bubbles. I mean, I find I still do get air bubbles, but you just get less this way. The air bubbles, by the way, I would fill in with more resin later on. I mean, they advise you to use like a vacuum chamber, but it's a bit difficult to set up, and it still doesn't work sort of fully unless you really know what you're doing. So this will take like 3 or 4 hours to set. There's lots of this sort of flashing, as they call it, which needs to be removed. So this is going to have to be, these will have to be cleaned up and sanded and prepared for using on the actual puzzles. But I am pretty pleased with these. I can't really see any air bubbles there, so it's they've come out quite good. If you think I what I'm doing here looks a bit awkward, it's really because I'm having to get the light in the correct position and get the camera in the correct position and still do the work. So it's not very natural way for me to do it. Obviously, normally I wouldn't be doing it in front of a camera, so it always looks a little bit bizarre when I'm working on these. So this is 240 grit wet and dry sandpaper to make the pieces smooth. I use wet and dry because it doesn't clog so quickly, so you sort of wash the paper and it lasts a lot longer. I do sort of need to do the edges because the moulding's never perfect, and once you start using the moulds, after about 3 or 4 castings, they start to deteriorate, which means your pieces are always going to come out a little bit rough. But a little bit of cleaning and I think these are fine. They are a little bit grey though, which is standard. You're never going to get the perfect black finish. However much you polish it, you're not going to get a black finish, so I will need to spray paint them a little bit later. So here's one of the cheap scoops that I mentioned earlier. Just got to remove all the stickers first. The best way to do this is to warm up the puzzle a little bit. I did warm up this one to some extent, but probably should have done a bit more, because then the stickers come off really quickly. So I'm just going to roughen the surfaces a little bit. It's sort of strange, you use sandpaper to smooth, but you also use sandpaper to roughen, if that makes sense. This is so when I stick the pieces on, they'll just stick a bit better. Because the plastic is kind of quite an oily plastic, and sometimes it just doesn't stick to them. So I'm removing 4 of the caps. These are the 4 that can come off, and the other 4 can't because they're slightly different. Well, they can't at the moment, but I'll go on to them in a minute. And I'm just cutting these down. So the way I've designed it is that I need to cut these corners off. I could have made the icosahedron bigger, and so it wouldn't require the corners to be cut off. But I mean, this only takes a few minutes, so I thought I'd go for like a smaller and lighter weight icosahedron. And when I say lighter weight, it will be quite heavy, even though it's partially hollow. It's still pretty heavy. So to get to the other corners, I need to take it apart. Now these are a little bit different. When I truncate them, you're cutting through a central screw that holds like a cap on the end. So once I've gone through that screw, typically the little cap comes off, as you can see here, and I'm going to then have to glue that back on again later. Some super glue gel, and that's how I'm going to glue the little caps on. It's always a good idea to, if you're gluing sort of smallish things, it's a good idea to just put a blob of it on something like a piece of glass and use a needle to put it on, because just squeezing it out of a tube onto these sort of places would be really awkward. It literally sets in like about sort of 3 or 4 seconds. Now I'm just lowering these pieces a little bit, just tidying them up. Right, that's all the pieces I've prepared now, and I can start sticking on the actual cast resin parts. I can start off with these 6 pieces that go onto the scoop centres. So that's those 6 done, and now I can gonna assemble the puzzle for the to put the corners in. Because when I put the corners in, they might, if they stand up a little bit high, I might still need to make some adjustments. So I just want to make sure everything's gonna line up correctly before I actually start gluing things. Even though these scoops are cheap, they're a lot better than the original ones that I got from Meffert's. Mainly because I've got like these kind of speed cube type wings to them, which makes it very difficult to pop them, but that also makes them quite tricky to put together, so you do need to undo a screw really. And at this stage, I can see everything's lined up, so I'm very pleased with this. It resembles the CAD work I was doing earlier. As I said before, the pieces come out a little bit grey, so I just do a very rough coat of a very light coat of spray paint. Whenever you do this, always make sure you hold it about a foot away. A lot of people hold it too close, and then you just get like all kind of messy areas. Right, so now more assembly. And it should be the final assembly. Just tighten up the screw and make sure everything's the right kind of tension. Everything feels smooth, and I'm very happy with it at this stage. And it's just the final 4 triangular pieces can go into place, and then that should be done. Well, until the stickers. Yep, that feels fine, and I think it looks okay. So now the stickers. This is just kind of the rough design for the stickers, and as usual these days, I'm using Oliver's stickers. I have to highly recommend his shop, and I'll put a link to him in my description. Basically, it's just because I'm a bit lazy these days to do my own, And also, of course, when he does them with a proper like sticker cutter, and they come out absolutely perfectly, you know, professionally cut kind of thing. So I sent him one of my icosahedrons with instructions about the colours, and then of course he cut them for me. The colour scheme I'm using is going to have 10 different colours on the 20 sides, so I'm going to double up on each side. So here I'm doing red opposite red. Now that might look as though it's going to make the puzzle easier, but actually it doesn't, because all the pieces are still unique, and you can't swap them around, or and each one has to be the correct orientation. And I'm picking 10 colours because it's just more difficult than deciding on 20 colours. Right, so I go back to normal speed for the last few of the orange stickers, and at this stage I'm very happy with it, and I think Oliver's done an amazing job with these stickers. I'm really pleased with the colours and the general look of the puzzle. So once again, thank you, Oliver. This puzzle will be up for auction sometime, probably in 2021. I'm not doing it immediately after upload, but maybe in like a couple of months or so. So maybe sort of around Easter time. Right, there we are, one 10 colour custom made icosahedron puzzle based on my original 1996 ones.